For the second year in a row, we have returned to Southern California for one of the most exciting new disciplines in motocross, an end-of-the-year competition that has quickly become both a rider and fan favorite. Head-to-head, wide-open racing on a straight course just over half a mile in length. Think of it as supercross without the turns. Two riders, man on man, with a simple objective. Be the fastest rider and you can move on to the next round. There is no room for error and no time for you to make any adjustments. Unless, of course, you'd like to go home early. This is Straight Rhythm and you're watching the Red Bull Signature Series. Of the Red Bull Signature Series, and allow me to welcome you to Southern California and the Pomona Fairplex, which for years was a legendary horse racing track until it shuttered its doors last year. Now, it is reborn as the home of Straight Rhythm, the head-to-head dirt bike drag race of the year. What was once the home stretch is now a half-mile course made up of 80 jumps, 3 speed checks, 150 feet of whoops, a 5 tabletop rhythm section, and an 80-foot jump into the finish line. Our big story today, of course, the return to competition of defending Straight Rhythm champ James Bubba Stewart after a controversial year-long ban from racing. He also has some riders that are gunning for him. New to the event, Ryan Dungey, who comes off of his back-to-back championships in both Supercross and Motocross, and the 2013 250 Supercross champion, Ken Roczen, who has made the move up with the big boys to the 450s. We are all set for our first run, so we're gonna check in with Jason Wigand and the legend himself, Ricky Johnson.
Well, thanks, Al. Jason Wigand, joined by 7-time AMA National Motocross and Supercross champion Rick Johnson. And everyone here is intrigued at this event because it's only the second time they've ever ridden on a Supercross track unwound. We still have the fun stuff, all the obstacles. No one's exactly sure what happens, though, when you take the turns out.
But with Supercross, they say jump for show, turn for dough. That goes out the window. Right here, you got straight, you have jumps, whoops, you have tabletops with a huge finish line jump at the end. But also endurance is going to play part in this because a lot of drivers think, oh, it's only a 45-second run, but you have to do it time after time after time. It's like intervals.
Yeah, and they're going to be really intense because this is head-to-head racing. We'll give you an idea what the format is. Much like drag racing, we'll start with a bracket. Riders go head-to-head. The best 2 out of 3 runs advances to the next round. Eventually, we'll get down to the finals and crown ourselves a champion. And we have a world-class field of riders on hand. For more on that, let's introduce Will Christian to talk about this deep field.
Thank you, guys. Well, like you said, an incredibly stacked field here at 2015 Red Bull Straight Rhythm. Last year, we saw brothers Malcolm and James Stewart both standing on the podium, James taking the 2014 title, and his brother Malcolm standing in third position. But with Malcolm moving into the light class this year, there is a chance that we might actually see both of them stand on top of the podium. But there's a lot of talented riders who'd like to stand in their way and stop them from achieving that goal. For Malcolm, that includes 3 Geico Honda teammates, including that of Matt Bashalia. KTM have 6 riders in both classes, including the current motocross and supercross champion Ryan Dungey. And of course, we can never leave out RCH rider Ken Roczen, who actually qualified with the fastest time yesterday. So, with such a talented field and an unknown track, it really is, guys, anybody's game here today.
Thanks, Will. So we'll show you the bracket as it stands right now. Earlier, Ken Roczen defeated Tevin Tapia and Andrew Short defeated Vince Friese, so it'll be Short versus Roczen in our next run. Brayton took out Enignap, Wilson took out Remet, so it'll be Brayton against Wilson. On the other side, you'll have Dungy versus Partridge and Stewart versus Hansen. Schmidt, Alessi, Chisholm, and Raper put in good, strong efforts, but they ultimately were eliminated. Andrew Short and Ken Roczen will be facing off here in this round. These guys are good buddies off the track. Kenny spent a summer at Andrew's house 2 years ago training in the United States when he was coming over from Germany. But now, friendship, put it aside, it's time to race.
It was Andrew Short with a really fast time. We see Roczen with very, very hard scrubs throwing it side to side. Andrew Short a little bit more clean than the lane closest to us on the number 29, but Roczen by a nose.
Yeah, we like those worst racing terms.
Yeah,
okay,
we'll
see if Short can close back in, and he actually has. So Short right there with Roczen, who is your fast qualifier through that section, though.
But
Roczen,
it was the dragon back.
Yep.
It was the dragon back that made the difference. And going into the whoops, we see that the whoops is going to be the determining factor because they're doing the jumps about the same. So Kenny with about a 2-bike-length lead going into this last couple sections, does a little bit of a goon ride, and then pulls it off.
Roczen takes it over Short. 42-1 for Roczen.
That is the time to beat so far, ladies and gentlemen. So Andrew Short came up a little bit short, but he gets another run at it.
Let's go back and look at this run again. Big hard scrub from Roczen here, but Short's able to stay with him through this first series of jumps, the six pack and the wall. The dragon back and this section of boots. Man, that's where Roczen really put it together and put some distance between himself and his buddy. And then for fun, gets way up over the front of the motorcycle here as he enters the grandstand so the fans can see him showing off a bit as he goes on to take the victory. Rematch here between the buddies, Andrew Short on the BTOsports.com KTM and the Soaring Eagle Jimmy John's Suzuki of Ken Roczen. Now Short, he's over the age of 30. He admits he's not one of these young, high-flying guys. He told me this morning, he's like, this race is kind of an anti-me. But he wants to work on the weaknesses and get faster in a sprint-type event. So that's why he's here.
Ken Roczen over-jumped a little bit in that preferred left lane. But you see Short, very consistent. It's going to take a mistake by Roczen for Short to beat him. But anything can happen in straight rhythm.
Short was close for the majority of the first run, but a quick early edge for the 94 Roczen this time.
We saw Short come up a little short. Short come up a little bit short on that last transition, but you see right there, Roczen tipping what I would call the camelback just a little bit, with one hump smaller to clear in the next one. And right now he's on the step on, step off. He looks like he has a clean run all the way to the finish. A little fist pump. Little tribute to Jeff Ward back in the day.
He's a showman for sure. The young German, Ken Roczen. A big whip at the finish line to celebrate that victory. Sorry, Shorty, I love you, but I gotta move on. Short is eliminated, Roczen moves on to the semifinals. We'll give you a couple of replays and show how Roczen did it.
Both of them almost identical, by a nose Roczen, but it's the scrubbing technique of Ken Roczen that where he gets the advantage at the beginning of the race.
At this point, he's got a solid lead, so why not throw a little flair in it for the fans? Yeah. Fist pump. Short's not close enough to do anything about that. Look over at the fans as well. Ken Roczen certainly having some fun here and riding darn fast as well. He's down with Will.
Yes, he is indeed. Ken, congratulations. Two solid races there to get you through to the next round. How important is the scrubbing here? It seemed to be helping you an awful lot there.
Oh, yeah, for sure. I mean, we don't have any corners, so you got to make out the time somewhere. So jumping's everything. You got to try to scrub whatever you can. Oh, yeah. You got to try and scrub whatever you can. But at the same time, you got to get your timing right and not clip anything or overshoot anything. So.
Now, you look like you're having a lot of fun out there. Obviously, it's an intimidating track, but you guys are enjoying here at Rebel Straight Rhythm.
Yeah, for sure. You know, this is just a fun race, so we're all having some fun and trying not to go too crazy.
Congratulations. Thank you.
Let's show you what a Supercross track unwound looks like in today's course preview with open class competitor Ken Roczen.
You watch
understanding as he comes up to these doubles, he has to use a little bit of brake not to overjump. We saw Jesse Nelson smash his chin on the bike. So right here, you can see the wheel turning off to the side. He scrubs, and here he goes for the longer jump, shortens it, then goes for the longer jump, then back into the triple, back to a double. Now, a little speed check here to get back on the ground, up the camelback, on, step on, step off, step on, step off, then another camelback, and next thing you know, right down the whoops, high speed. We can try to get up to fourth gear with a little speed check, and then once again, back onto the step on, step off, and then a long double to get yourself ready for the last five rollers.
All right, thanks to Ken Roczen for that course preview. Roczen just beat Andrew Short, so he's into the open class semis. And whoever wins the next heat will meet him there. And just a reminder, it's best two out of three in each round, and the riders must switch lanes between races. Next up, we're going to have Justin Brayton against Dean Wilson. Last year, these two faced off. It was nearly a dead heat every time they raced. In qualifying, they've been close. In practice, they've been close. Let's see what happens when they're racing.
Similar motorcycles, but completely different body makeups. You got Wilson, who's about, I'd say about 6 foot tall, and Brayton, who's quite a bit shorter, but both about the same in weight. And right now, they're running neck and neck.
And they've been neck and neck every time they've done this event together, last year and this year, and this is the closest run we've seen so far. Wilson at the 15, Brayton at the 10.
Now let's see who goes through the whoops the fastest, because this is going to determine what happens. And here you see Justin Brayton pulled about a half a bike length lead.
And a lot of riders feel that the lane that Brayton is in is the slower lane, but he's actually pulled ahead now. Wilson, down the stretch they come. The 10 is going to take it out of the 15. Justin Brayton leads Dean Wilson.
With a 42.2, that is one of the fastest times that we've seen all day long. Roczen with a 10th quicker, but got to give it to Justin Brayton. Pulled it together, and now he gets the third lane.
Great competition between these two. The whoop section allowed Brayton to extend that lead.
Yep, you see it's the entry speed of Brayton. You notice he floats that one a little bit, but he gets back into rhythm, hitting everyone, floats one, and he extends it. That's a scary way of going through there, but you got to give it to the guy. He's got confidence.
Wilson a little bit side to side, a swap through the whoops, and that allowed Brayton to have this kind of a gap, and that would carry him to the checkered flag. Back to the line we go with what we believe is the closest matchup of this round, Wilson versus Brayton. And Brayton was only able to get ahead in the last probably quarter of the track. The last time around, they were side by side through the first 75%. But Wilson's going to need the top Brayton here, or he's eliminated.
It seems like that the right lane is faster at the beginning, but the guys seem to make it up from the middle on in the left lane. So we'll see if Dean Wilson gets out to that early lead and what Justin Brayton can do with it.
Yeah, there's something in the middle leading to the whoops that has allowed a couple of riders to get ahead when we normally have a side-by-side battle. That's what Brayton did the first time. Let's see if he can do it again. Brayton on the 10, already establishing the lead on Wilson. Wilson, the Scottish rider on the Red Bull KTM, the BTOsports.com KTM of Brayton, two different teams, but pretty similar equipment.
But they took that section completely different. Here we see Justin Brayton with a slide advantage once he gets on. Now let's see what happens in the whoops. He's over the dragon back into the whoops. So Brayton's been probably the most consistent through there all day long. Now he's got about a 2-5 lead over Dean Wilson.
This is a great run from Brayton, one of the cleanest and fastest we've seen throughout the entire event. I'm really curious what the last time it's going to be. 42-2 for Brayton. 42.283 for Brayton. Let's see how that lines up. Yeah, that's the fastest that we've seen so far from this group. Justin Brayton, the fastest lap time of anyone in this bracket.
Here we see Brayton at the beginning staying a little bit lower, and here's where they do completely different sections. You see one guy's up, the other guy's down, and that's what's great about straight rhythm is that you can try your own formula, what's going to work the best. They're doing the same number of jumps, just different sequence, like a double, triple, or a triple quad, but they're doing it in different times.
Let's send it down to Sal Masekela.
This track has evolved since its inception 3 years ago. Select riders came out, liked what they saw, and gave a green light for full-fledged competition. 2014 was the inaugural straight rhythm at the legendary NHRA drag strip. Now that location presented challenges, but ultimately was still a huge success with James Stewart standing on top of the podium. Today in 2015, our event organizers were able to say, hey, Let's go across the grounds over to the Pomona Fairplex, this shuttered horse track that would be the perfect blank canvas to make this year's event the ultimate head-to-head proving ground.
So on this course, we have just under 10,000 cubic yards of dirt.
It's a huge factor to get the dirt just right to build this course.
We're always wondering, like, do we have good dirt? Where are we gonna get the dirt? Because the dirt is our most important thing. Getting the right amount of water is really the key thing. If the dirt's not watered correctly, then, you know, the track doesn't work the way it's supposed to.
It's gotta be processed right, otherwise this thing blows apart and we don't have an event.
In terms of the build, we have 9 guys on our staff here. So until contest day, we have 2 full weeks, including weekends. And if you calculate that between 10 and 12 hours a day, that's a hell of a lot of hours.
The biggest challenges with this course, building it, getting everything on point. So when we get done with it and you have that overhead shot, like, everything just looks sweet. It would be very noticeable for straight rhythm to not be straight.
When we did the first year, we had everything GPS, but here we had some issues with our CADs and everything laid out, so we just went ahead and did it the old-fashioned way, and Jason pulled some string lines, and I held one end, he held the other, and the guys did everything in between, so it worked out really good.
Definitely some big drastic changes. Last year, straight out of the gate, we have the elevated start. It's really going to be a unique obstacle. It's something they've never done before. Right into a very technical rhythm section, a six-pack that the guys are going to have to get back, power to the ground, get to the first speed check, and that starts the first actual rhythm section. And we'll probably see some guys mixing up their lines.
If you look at last year, we basically had a real high-speed finish. We have a little bit of a high-speed finish now, but we have a lot more technical aspects coming in right towards the actual finish line, so a lot more chances for passing and opportunities for things at the end.
Every year, we push ourselves to get better for the course itself and the obstacles we put in, to challenge the rider, the speeds that they're able to carry. So this is definitely going to be spectacular.
And talking to Jason Baker in the days leading up to this race, they were actually greeted with some rain. And in motocross terms, that's really a good thing, RJ, because it meant that the dirt was a little bit more moldable and should be a little less dusty and more traction this year. Here's our updated bracket. We've completed one side of it, and now we're moving to the next side. That'll be Kyle Partridge against Ryan Dungey. Now, Dungey, you could argue, is the best rider in the world right now, but don't sleep on Partridge. Very tall rider and really seems to excel in this straight line racing. Was very fast in the first round.
And at this point, he's in the preferred line, so let's see if Partridge can pull it together. Dungey on the ground a little bit quicker, utilizing, not scrubbing, but getting back on the ground a little bit quicker. A lot of that is suspension setup. Jim Anderson works with really close with the guys from KTM, putting a great set of suspension underneath that KTM.
But as we expected, look at Partridge, keeping Dungey in sight.
A slight mistake by Dungey, losing a little momentum, but now he's got his bike back underneath him, up that dragon back, and now he's pulled back out. Now here, Partridge.
Partridge with a shot at it, he knows it.
Puts that much effort into it, and that his tall height helped him save that bike. You saw he was going over the bars. He does the funky looking fist pump, and he pulls it out.
Yeah, that last jump, he was nose down, Partridge, but he did not care about style points. He was going for it. Watch how low the front of the bike is. He holds it up, but that allows Dungey to open up the lead and go on for the win. So a great battle there, and we'll re-rack it. And remember, they have to switch lanes. So now Dungey goes to the preferred lane, and it's 2 out of 3. So Partridge has to win this one, or he will be eliminated. Love to force that third race against Dungey. Partridge actually got ahead of Dungey late in the first race. Dungey was able to rally back and win it, and Partridge not intimidated again. He's going right after him.
Yeah, Partridge is a gamer, man. He's never going to give up. He's never going to lay over. Doesn't matter who he's talking about. Here he scrubs a little bit and tries a different rhythm, but didn't seem to pay off.
Yeah, Dungy getting an early lead on Partridge. That's what he was unable to do the first time they raced. But the whoop section is good for Partridge, and we're headed toward that area of the course now.
Ryan Dungy, this looks like the fastest run I've seen out of Dungy and the most aggression that I've seen out of him all day, and actually yesterday as well. But Partridge, as I said, is a gamer and is right there.
He's keeping him honest, but he's not going to be able to topple him. Ryan Dungy goes up 2-0 and will move on to the semifinals. Woo, 41-7 for Dungy into the 41s.
I hate to say it, but man, I saw that coming. I said
you
that's
said
the most aggressive that he's seen and stuff like that. So I'm giving myself a little pat on the back. Thank you. But it was up at the top. You can see he stays a little bit lower, and where Partridge over jumps a little bit, but Dungy is doing what Dungy does best, not making any mistakes.
Let's check in with Ryan Dungy. He's down with Will.
Ryan, through to the semifinals now. Solid riding there from you. What's the key to this track?
Consistency, obviously, and just hitting your marks. I mean, the rhythm's pretty, we're all doing pretty much the same thing. Trying a few things, but it doesn't seem like it's any faster. But that last go, Partridge, he's got the whoops out and the dragon back, so I had to be extra on top of it. But looking forward to advancing to the next round, but consistency and just hitting your marks, that's what I'd say is key, and momentum.
Right. Thank you, Ryan.
Thank you.
Let's send it down to Sal Masekela.
Three-time World Supercross champion James Bubba Stewart is back. After a year-long ban from the sport that he loves, Bubba has had all year to practice, fanning and fueling a fire that burns deep inside of him to win. Now at an event that he dominated last year with its head-to-head wide-open racing and his mastery of his signature Bubba scrub, the straight rhythm course and format suit him better than anyone, as he hopes to return to both championship form and glory and a rightful place atop the podium.
For me, to be able to win in 2014, it was fun. I enjoyed the event a lot.
The first ever open class champ of Red Bull straight rhythm is James Stewart.
I think I had motivation over some of the guys. You know, they knew it was a supercross track. They knew I was really good on it. The strongest person was my brother, so I kind of had my control over him.
Stewart versus Stewart, and it's going to be James getting a win.
So it's going to be nice to have my first race in over a year. Coming back, the defending champion, I might be a little rusty, but I expect to get it done.
I haven't raced in a year, so you don't get that sensation of racing. And it's kind of weird that I come to the one event that all it is about sprint speed. And normally that's my forte, but you know, when you're not racing, you kind of lose that a little bit. So, you know, but we'll see.
I think for 2015, I expect a lot stronger competition. You know, there'll be more guys out here. Everybody will kind of know the format a little bit.
Having Ken and Ryan out here, it definitely steps it up, and those guys are riding pretty good. Obviously, Ryan's a champion, and Ken, we know he knows how to scrub. So I hate to admit this, but I'm actually glad Malcolm's not racing, because homeboy's flying right now. So I guess I need to step up to little brothers part right now.
Got it.
I think I'm going to use this race as, you know, having some fun and, you know, being back into it again and, you know, using the motivation going into next year.
All right, so it's going to be interesting with Stewart. Yes, an event that seems so perfect for his skill set, but with not having raced in a year, really hard to predict how it's going to go. Here's the bracket so far. He mentioned Dungy and Roczen, and they have continued to move forward. Next up, we're going to have Josh Hansen against James Stewart, two of the most talented riders of all. Certainly, Stewart doesn't need much of an introduction. He won this race last year. He's a multi-time motocross and supercross champ. Now, Hansen's racing results might not match up to Stewart's on paper, but there are epic stories of Hansen out on practice days and out on the hills doing some amazing things on a bike. Let's see if he can translate it here.
If you hiccup, Josh Hansen is gonna make it up on you, but he's up against James Stewart, the defending champion of straight rhythm, and the guy that typically doesn't make many mistakes.
Hansen right there with Stewart right now. You can't call it. In fact, I think Hansen is edged ahead now.
He's looking over. Josh, put your eyes back on the prize and quit watching James. He's probably over there thinking, I gotta get to hang out with James Stewart today. But right there, he's giving away in the whoops, and now it's the advantage. We keep talking about that. I hate to be redundant, but it's the whoops that are making the difference here today.
We're seeing something in the middle of the track that is helping to separate these riders. Stewart has has it figured out. Hansen is close early, but down the stretch, it's the number 7, James Stewart, taking the win.
Josh Hansen was matching James Stewart, you know, bump for bump at the beginning, but it was the middle and the end where James Stewart started to excel.
Yeah, absolutely, and we'll show that to you here. See these six-pack doubles and the wall jump early. They're side by side, but then midway through, Stewart has a lead, and his speed in the whoops is just ridiculous at this point, and he carries that speed all the way through to the end. And they'll re-rack it and rematch them.
Well, this will be interesting. James Stewart against Josh Hansen. The winner goes up against Ryan Dungey. Hansen has to beat Stewart here, or he is eliminated. And Hansen has the speed and talent to do it, but you're facing a tall order to say you got to go out there and go faster than James Stewart.
Well, that is not an easy task. If someone gave me that job, I don't know, you don't want to tap out because anybody can win. And Josh Hansen, sure enough, pulls the lead on
absolutely
James Stewart.
Going for it, he had a little lead at Stewart at one point, and then Stewart in the second half of the track found something and was able to get by him. And right now, Hansen has him beaten. Here comes Stewart, though, again, finding something different.
Slightly different rhythm for James Stewart. Hansen had to pause a little bit, and he pulls off. I think he might have jammed an ankle or something like that. He got off rhythm a little bit, and that forced him out. So right now, James Stewart just has to get to the finish line, and he's into the next bracket.
Yeah, Hansen has gone off the track. Not sure if it's a bike problem or something wrong with him physically, but here comes Stewart. Huge leap over the rollers, bringing him to the finish.
Let's look back at that replay. We're not exactly sure what happened, but Josh Hansen has been nursing a sore wrist a little bit. So he comes down, you can see him come up. As he lands here, comes up a little bit long, and it jams his wrist. The next thing you know, you see him start to pull himself off. He's just like, well, I'm not gonna take a chance at it. So smart move by Josh Hansen. You know, we can see him hold his left hand. So hopefully he gets better.
Let's send it down to Sal Masekela.
Last year, Malcolm Stewart dominated both this new course and format, nearly bringing home that checkered flag, except his brother James had other plans. However, in 2015, Malcolm makes the switch from the 450cc bike to the 250cc bike and finds himself head-to-head with the likes of Jesse Nelson, Shane McElrath, Justin Hill, and Matt Bisseglia, to name a few. The big question is, can that experience and command of last year's open class translate and land him once again on the podium to possibly become the champ in the lights?
Malcolm Stewart's gonna hold him off, but as his dad said, that's not a factory bike. They put it all together themselves.
Last year, I didn't have a factory ride coming into Red Bull Straight Rhythm, so this year I got picked up by Geico and Supercross and got hired again for the 2016, so they're a factory 250 team, so I'm around the 250 this year. Major differences, the intensity is a lot more different in the 250 class. You know, you're kind of still trying to make a name for yourself, and the 450 guys are already settled, so they're on the way out. And 250, you're trying to earn that spot for the 450 ride.
The biggest difference between 250 and 450 is engine. 450 is obviously much power, has a lot more torque, so it's much quicker, a lot more to hang on to. Going from the 450 to the 250, the power difference is very difficult to get used to. You don't have the power to get over obstacles, you have to carry more speed. If you make mistakes, you kind of ruin your entire run.
The track's a lot more different than it was last year, so a lot more technical. I feel like there's way more jumps, and the whoops are a lot more tougher. The 250F definitely makes the ride a lot more harder, especially with me being a bigger guy. On the 450, when I rode it last year at Red Bull Straight Rhythm, I could overjump something and still had enough power. Where this year, since I'm back to light class, you know, I have to make sure I hit all my markers right. So a step back in a way, but I like it because I do have a factory ride now, so I can't complain. I'm still nervous. I'm still tripping off the start. We'll see.
Let's check in with Will.
Thank you, guys. Well, I'm catching up with yesterday's fastest qualifier, Malcolm Stewart. Malcolm, tell us a little bit about the track. You obviously had the fastest time out there. That's got to make you feel good moving into today.
Yeah, no, getting the fastest time today or yesterday was amazing. And track is tough. It's definitely a lot more difficult than the Red Bull Straight Rhythm last year. So bumping down to the 250 class. Now I'm a factory ride. Last year I didn't have a ride, so feels good to get a ride this year. It doesn't really matter what bike I'm on, just as long as I'm doing all right.
Now tell us a little bit more. You mentioned how the track differs from last year. How would you say it does? And for you now riding the 250 class, how's that going to change things for you?
I have to pinpoint my hit my marks right. Definitely on the 450, it had, you know, obviously a lot more power. So if I mess up, I was able to pull it back together. Where this year, I'm back on the 250. I'm probably the heaviest rider out here right now. So I have to hit my marks right to be competitive. So track's good today, and I'm just looking forward to it.
Now, you obviously challenged a lot of the guys in the open class last year, including your brother. Came away standing on the podium with a third, and now all eyes are on you to take the win here in lights. Do you think that's something you can achieve?
Oh, no, I definitely feel like I can achieve it. Like I said, practice was great yesterday. Long as I'm doing good today, but it's different with the gate drop. You know, once racing, you have your competitor. Now you guys are, instead of being a second, you're half a second to, you know, a few seconds faster. So it's a lot different, but like I said, we're going to see what we can do, and it would be good to win it and then also have my brother win it. So that would definitely be two brothers on top.
We'll be excited to see that, Malcolm. Good luck out there. Thank you.
Here's the lights semifinal bracket. We already talked about our fastest four in open with Brayton, Roxon, Dungey, and Stewart. Here are your best four in the lights division. Malcolm Stewart will be going against Jordan Smith, and Jesse Nelson will go against Shane McElrath, and that will be our next set of races, our semifinals. Jordan Smith, young kid out of North Carolina, completed his first professional season here in 2015, but did race this race last year as an amateur. So he does have some experience in this type of event. Malcolm Stewart raced it last year in the open class on a big bike and finished third overall. Now he's in the 250s. And Stewart on the number 50, just pulling ahead, just a tad from his teammate Smith.
Smith over jumping just a little bit, but staying right in the game. And as we talked earlier, the left lane is the preferred lane, but Smith losing just that little bit. We talked about it, but he cannot give up. He has to keep pushing, because even though this is just the first round, if he loses this, he can come back in the next round. So he's got to learn something and not give up.
You can see a lot more intensity out of Malcolm Stewart in this run. Bike's been up and down, front low, rear low, sideways at times. He is really pushing for a fast lap time now. Let's see what he can do. 42.6, that's pretty good for a 250.
That is phenomenal for a 250. So taking a look back at what happened to Smith, it was just a small, he came up a little bit short. Here we see they're matching about identical, both scrubbing the same direction. They both like to throw it off to the left. And the next thing you know, you see Smith, when he comes up here, he comes up a little bit short. And the next thing you know, back he goes.
So Malcolm Stewart wins the first race against Jordan Smith. It's best two out of three, though. So they'll have a rematch coming up. Now we have a battle between the other teammates, the Lucas Oil Troy Lee KTMs, the 13 of Jesse Nelson, the 30 of Shane McElrath. And they've been chasing each other quite a bit. It was a big motocross race at the U.S. Grand Prix 3 weeks ago. Nelson won it. McElrath finished second. Let's see how it turns out here in Straight Rhythm.
Neck and neck, they're both side by side. They're both in the rev chip at the same time, with Jesse Nelson with a little bit harder scrub.
So Nelson in the 13, just ahead of McElrath. McElrath has actually come back now on the 30 and has evened him up.
It's going to be the one that's going to be the deciding factor here, Jason. So as we see him going up the dragon back, McElrath pulls in front of Jesse Nelson.
Wow, taking the lead away from his teammate.
But he hesitates a little bit coming into the whoops, and Nelson comes back. So now it's going to be a drag race to the finish.
Down the stretch they come, wheel to wheel. Oh, mistake! And that is going to allow McElrath to get away. Nelson cased the one tabletop, and that's the difference between a win and finishing second to your teammate. Calling a case. So what happens is you get the front wheel over the top and the back wheel doesn't get over, and you hit the bottom of the engine, the cases of the engine, as they call it, on the jump.
Here watch you Jesse Nelson. He actually scrubs a little bit too much as he comes up here, doesn't get quite the run that he needs. His rear wheel drops, bam, grabs the case. And why they call it casing is, like you said, it hits the pegs, it brings the bike to a complete stop, robs all the momentum, and McElrath walks away with the win. So Nelson gets another shot at it, but McElrath with a big confidence booster.
Hey folks, Jason Wygant alongside seven-time AMA motocross and supercross champion Rick Johnson. We have witnessed some great racing today, but I have a feeling things are going to get even better now. Gonna rejoin the semis for the 250s. Malcolm Stewart taking on Jordan Smith. Stewart took the win with a 42.6. It was a lightning fast performance for Malcolm Smith, or for Malcolm Stewart against Jordan Smith. That was a mistake that I was bound to make. Malcolm Stewart, that is James's younger brother. That was by far the best time we had seen anyone put together on a 250. So Smith has to go over that bar to stave off elimination on the number 39.
Smith with a slide advantage, and he's also in that preferred lane, but we've seen the right lane about a third of the way in be faster, so we'll see if Malcolm Stewart can make that time back up.
So far, so good, though, for Jordan Smith. Perfectly smooth in this section and holding Malcolm Stewart about a half a bike length behind it.
You can hear those bikes rev, as you were saying earlier, Jason, that they're wide open. They're giving it as much as they can right on the rev chip because they want to be in the highest horsepower as soon as the tires touch.
And Stewart in the center, able to take it back. But a good run through the whoops for Smith sets him up. He has an opportunity. Can he come back on Malcolm Stewart? Stewart on a number 50. Pulls it to the end. And he's going to the finals.
Both of those riders need to be very proud of that effort. It's great to see the intensity keep going up faster and faster and faster each time.
Jordan Smith, young kid out of North Carolina, only a little over a year into his professional career, gave Malcolm Stewart a run, ultimately eliminated. I think he matched or even exceeded Malcolm through the whoops.
It was close, but I think Malcolm had him just by a little bit. You can see he's hanging off the back. Smith giving a great run and 100% effort, and he makes it. You can see swapping side to side, but it's Malcolm Stewart that stays a little bit lower. Here's comes the step on, step off to the finish where he makes the difference.
And a little look over the shoulder. Malcolm just knew exactly what he needed. How far over the edge did he need to go to hold on for the victory? He's able to keep it in control, and he acknowledges the fans. Let's go down to Will Christian.
Malcolm, that was quite the race there. Jordan Smith was not going to let you have that easy, but you're now through to the final.
Yeah, no, it feels good to go to the final, so I'm excited. Shane just got that one, so it should be a good battle. I don't know. I think my teammate still has a shot to get on the podium, so we'll see how those two duke it out. But overall, pressure's off, so no matter what, if I get first or I'll get second, no matter what. But we're going to take this win, though. I'm telling you that now.
Well, I was just going to say, you said pressure's off, but a lot of people are expecting to see you standing on top of the podium there. Have you got any more? Can you dig any deeper here to get this final done?
Oh, you know, there's always a final. You always can dig deep, you know. So we'll see what we can do. Like I said, hopefully we get on the we'll get this number one plate, and I'm trying to get that money. So I got to keep my lights on tonight.
Thank you, Malcolm. Malcolm Stewart, we're going to see him in the final.
Thanks, Will. So another teammate battle, as we'll have Jesse Nelson and Shane McElrath. McElrath took advantage of a mistake by Nelson the last time to take the victory. So Nelson has to win this one, or he will be eliminated.
And some riders, if they make a mistake like that, they crumble. They don't come back. Well, Jesse Nelson, he's already got stitches in his chin from yesterday. He looks past it. What happened two bumps ago doesn't matter. So I do not expect this to be a runaway from McElrath.
It's teammate versus teammate. Identical equipment in a race for the finals. McElrath a slight lead on that number 30.
What's funny is typically a rider just whips it to one side or scrubs to one side, but both these guys are ambidextrous. They're throwing it to the right and to the left, which is not common. Most of the time, they stick to one side they like better, but both these guys hit both sides.
McElrath still with the advantage. Time is running out on Nelson. He's going to have to blitz these whoops. He does, but he doesn't make up enough ground. Now he scrubs the backside of that skin check and allows him to get a pad of back around. Is going to get it by a tenth of a second.
Wait a minute, correction. It's McElrath by
a nose.
There we go.
Watching both of these guys scrubbing to the left, to the right. Unbelievable job. Here they see they're throwing into each other, away from each other, and it's so close. But McElrath like I said, this kid gains confidence every jump. So really, really proud of him.
Yeah, it looked like Nelson had him for a moment. This last speed check, the last big jump after these whoops made a huge difference and set them up for this stretch run. Little bit better leap for the 30 of McElrath, and that's the difference. Wow.
It's by a nose.
By a nose.
God, quit that. We're at the horse track. By a nose or by a knob.
Photo finish. Let's go down to Will Christian.
Shane, that was a solid semis run for you there. What was the difference, do you think?
Today, it's definitely all about limiting your mistakes. And even if you have to back it down just a little bit to not make a mistake, I think that sometimes that makes up for sending it sometimes. So it's just about that and just about having fun.
Now, yeah, Jesse did make some mistakes out there, and you clearly capitalized on it. But now you're up against Malcolm Stewart, a guy who really isn't going to give you too many mistakes to capitalize on. So what's your plan going forward? Are you going to have to be more aggressive here?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, this is the finals. This is for first. So we're going to go out and give it all we got and pull a little extra for this one.
Good luck out there. Thank you.
Thanks, Will. Well done so far for the very humble young rider, but yeah, he needs to pull something out. He's got the always flashy Malcolm Stewart in the finals. That is going to be a great matchup. Let's send it down to Sal Masekela.
Thank you, Jason. Who do you guys want to see matched up? What do you think about James Stewart's return to racing? And how about the fact that we got to take this old horse track and turn it into a motocross event like Straight Rhythm? We've got plenty to talk about, so why don't you get involved in our conversation? Follow the Red Bull Signature Series on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, or you can go to RedBullSignatureSeries.com, where we have even more exclusive content for you. Plus, you can also download the Red Bull TV app to watch this show and catch up on all episodes from every season. Ryan Dungey and Ken Roczen, two names that have dominated the Supercross and Motocross headlines for the past couple of years. Dungey coming off of his best season of his career, capturing both the 2015 450 Supercross and Motocross championships, and Roczen, the German boy wonder that captured the 2014 450 class championship, and to many is seen as the future face of the sport. Both were unable to compete in the inaugural Straight Rhythm last year, so they're labeled as rookies in this year's competition. However, having dominated in every other competition, both would like nothing more than to win a title here in 2015.
No, I don't consider myself an underdog at all. If it was my first year as a rookie, I could understand.
Oh, so if you go table, you triple.
I like this event just for the matter it's unique. We're used to having turns, and we have the obstacles, but usually we have turns and all kinds of different deals, so it's a very challenging track.
The track is, in my eyes, quite a bit gnarlier than last year, since everything's big and kind of peaked up.
Now if you go double, then you probably have a low one right there. You probably can.
Sometimes things look easier than they actually are, or the other way, sometimes things look harder than they actually are.
It's gonna be exciting. I'm looking forward to it.
Never enter a race that I don't intend to win. There's a lot of good guys here. You know, we got Stewart, Ken, Brayden, Short. I really just want to take it one race at a time and do the best I can. We're riding with Ken. It just so happened that's the way it ended up. We lined up next to each other. Although it doesn't matter who wins or loses, it's more of a practice time.
I don't think I'm not as good as Dungey at all. When it comes to technique, I think I'm the better rider, but he's always there and he's an absolutely tough competitor.
You can't overrush it. There's a lot of speed. You come into things really fast and you gotta be on top of your game.
I really just enjoy the track and I'm gonna give my best no matter who I race.
I think it's a lot of potential for this type of racing and the future of our sport. I hope it keeps growing and a lot of good things to come.
Well, we've arrived at the semifinals of the Open Class. We'll give these guys a shot at each other, Roczen versus Brayden. And I cannot wait to see Ryan Dungey battling with James Stewart. But first, it's Brayden and Roczen. Brayden is sneaky fast on this type of terrain. Guy was born and raised in Fort Dodge, Iowa, and raced a lot of local fair races instead of traditional motocross tracks. So they just kind of build a makeshift track in the middle of the fairgrounds. So he says he's used to man-made courses like this and always facing different obstacles. Every week, they build steep jumps and they build shallow jumps. He's able to adapt to new things. So that's why Brayton feels he's excelled in this event, making the finals last year. He looked awfully strong in the previous round. As for Ken Roczen, he's pretty fast no matter what type of event it is.
Well, right now what you're looking at is two main events, and I hate the two of these riders aren't going to make it to the next level because they're all so fast and they all deserve to be there. So it's one of those things, you know, you watch certain shows and you like both teams. Well, guess what? I like all four riders, and I hate that two of them aren't going to make it to the main.
Roczen, the 21-year-old out of Germany, now lives here in the United States, spends a lot of his time in Florida, but every one of these riders also spends a few months a year here in Southern California. This is where the teams are located, so this is where they'll do a lot of their testing and the development on the motorcycles. So for a lot of them, this is kind of a stepping stone toward 2016. First chance to shake down some new parts of the motorcycle and kind of see where you are. It's certainly not a traditional supercross style race since we don't have turns, but these guys all want to get an edge on each other anytime they line up.
But I think the rider that runs the Red Bull Straight Rhythm is going to walk away with knowledge that a rider doesn't, because you're pushing so hard. And as we said, James Stewart went stiffer on a suspension, so he's learning how much harder he can hit obstacles.
Brayton on the 10, Roczen on the 94. Here we go in the semis.
Slight advantage to Roczen, but Brayton seems to come back in this middle section. So right now, advantage goes to Brayton.
And it's wheel to wheel again. Over the tables together.
I like a little correction by Brayton. He grabbed the clutch, tapped the back brake to get the front wheel down, to get the rear wheel to clear the obstacle. But now it was the dragging back where Roczen made the big advantage, but it's been Brayton that's been fast over the whoop. So now we're down to the final stretch.
And they are wheel to wheel again. Slight advantage to Roczen. Brayton is on top of those jumps a little better. He stays lower. He pulls side by side. But Roczen is going to pull back away again and take the win.
Brayton was a little bit quicker over the tabletops, but it was Roczen that manualed all the way through the last five bumps that made the difference.
Roczen takes a close victory over Brayton. It was a 41.6 for Roczen, a 41.8 to Brayton. 0.2 seconds is the difference. Roczen motioning towards the crowd. He is having a good time today.
Watching the replay, here we got this. We're going through the dragging back, and this is where Roczen made the difference. And then we're looking at the finish line where he manualed the last five bumps, and that was the difference between second and first.
So Brayton back up against the wall. He'll have to beat Roczen the next time out, or he is eliminated. And here we go. Here we go. Ryan Dungey against James Stewart, two of the biggest names in the sport. Both are two-time Supercross champions. We've never seen them in a head-to-head format like this until now. Dungey on the 5, Stewart on the 7. Dungey known for being smooth, smart, calculated, consistent, strong. Stewart so spectacular and fast.
I can't imagine the adrenaline that's going through both of these guys knowing who they're up against.
Slight edge to Dungey as they drop into the course. Stewart coming back using the scrub to his advantage. He has a little lead. Now Dungey has it again.
I love the big scrubs out of Ryan Dungey. So we've seen that he is learning. Even though he's such a consummate professional, he pulls out on James Stewart.
And Stewart quickly answers back. They've gone past each other, what, 4 or 5 times in this run already. Center of the track favors Stewart. Now Dungey's going to have to find something through the loops. Stewart has him. Dungey going to keep the bike low on the tabletop. He's not giving up. Can he get the bike side of the table and come back? He does. Ryan Dungey beats James Stewart in a come-from-behind effort.
That's what I'm talking about, people. That was a race of champions right there. James Stewart didn't relax, didn't make a mistake, but Ryan Dungey just dug a little bit deeper. So great, great run. And now we're set up. This could be the first three heat race format that we've seen.
The fans are going crazy here at the Fairplex.
Here you see Ryan Dungey just hang it all out, completely giving everything he's got, scrubs a little bit, gets a little lower, and then just manuals the rest of them. James swaps a little bit. Great job for Ryan Dungey.
First time through all the practices, qualifying, and races that we've seen someone make a pass in that final roller section. Ryan Dungey just digging deep, putting the bike on the ground, getting the horsepower into the finish line jump. and that's the first time ever Stewart's been beaten in a round at Straight Rhythm. He has a shot to come back and beat Dungeon their next run, but he went 2-0 in every race he's done at this event until now. Back to the semifinals in the open class, Ken Roczen against Justin Brayton. Brayton put in a great run, but Roczen had a little bit more. So now Brayton has to win this one on the number 10, BTOsports.com, KTM, or he is eliminated. Ken Roczen on the Soaring Eagle, Jimmy John Suzuki, advance straight to the finals by winning 2-0, or will it take a third run?
I was just gonna say that we have not seen a third run yet, so definitely Kenny wants to qualify directly out of this, but Brayton is not gonna give it to him.
Big scrubs in opposite directions over this first six-pack. Three double jumps in a row. Then the first speed check slows them down, and they're quickly going to accelerate through this rhythm lane. Little advantage to Roczen, but not much.
Up, cased it a little bit. That's going to give Brayton a slight run coming back at him, but it's this dragging back that seemed to make the difference before.
Yeah, that is where Roczen, Stewart, and other riders have made up ground, but here comes Brayton to the whoops. He's going to give it a big run.
He's coming up tight on him. He overjumps a little bit. Roczen got him by a nose.
Final set of tabletops. Roczen appears to have it in control. Ken Roczen's going to the finals at Red Bull Straight Rhythm.
A little bit of confidence there, beating on his front wheel as he's racing.
Yeah, down. What was that? Was that that wasn't a mistake, right? That was showboating? Who knows?
I don't think he was straightening out his fender. But
this guy's having
excited.
A great time here.
Take another look at that. Here we see Roczen going through a Brayton, making a great run and actually gaining a little time on Roczen, but it wasn't quite enough. You see both these guys with perfect body position, perfect hitting every bump, floating a little bit, you know, taking a different look at it. What exactly Ken Roczen was doing, I guess he's telling everybody, hey, I won, but not really something that I would be stoked about if I was his manager, saying, hey, can you keep both hands on the handlebars?
Doesn't matter how you do it, he won a race. A little showboating as well. And then a little wheelie there, pumping one fist for the fans. That wasn't enough. Then he'd later do a double fist pump. This guy is happy to be here. Ryan Dungey and James Stewart for the first time in this event. Stewart, who won last year, didn't lose a single run. Now he has to win this or he is eliminated because Dungey passed him in the final 10 feet of their previous race. Stewart on the number 7. Back is up against the wall. He has to win this.
What does that do to you as a rider? For one, Ryan Dungey, the confidence that it gives him to beat James Stewart, the defending champion, who has never lost in this. And what does that do to James Stewart's confidence that got passed, not in the middle, didn't make a mistake, just got outran at the end. And it honestly, it looked like a little bit of suspension that Dungey just ran in the face a little harder. He was able to absorb it.
Here we go, Ryan Dungey. This year's star of both Motocross and Supercross, winning titles in both divisions. Stewart won this race last year. Has to win this run or his day is over as far as trying to compete for the gold. And Dungey has the lead right now.
Very animated Ryan Dungey. I like this. I think he's learning something from all this jumping and scrubbing and all the stuff back and forth. But James Stewart making his way back. And it's been the whoops that's been the difference. So let's see who goes through the whoops quicker.
Stewart.
And James Stewart.
Stewart leaped through the dragon back, got to the whoops more quickly. Now he has the lead. Dungey's going to have to pull off another come-from-behind effort. He's in position to do it. Here we go to the rollers. This time, Stewart comes out on top.
We're going to a third round. This is exactly what we as fans wanted to see, but as a rider, they do not want to see it.
And they're raising the bar and lowering the lap times. Dungey won the first run with a 41.4. This time, Stewart with a 41.2.
Exactly.
So they keep getting quicker because they keep pushing each other.
It's the fastest time that we've seen all day long. And both of them, I love the respect of the champions that said, hey, this is basically the main event because to us it is winner take all.
And these guys have a good history. They did a lot of riding and training together. Younger riders, now they're competitors. They can't ride together during the week, but it's still fun to race.
But it was James Stewart that had the entrance speed on the whoops that made the difference. He went in about a half length behind Dungey, and he walked away about a half length in front of him. And that was the difference. So once again, the whoops are making the difference.
Yeah, there's that whole dragon back section that leads to it, and that's what Stewart had right. Dungey tried to pull it off down the stretch like he did the first time. Stewart not going to get fooled again and has it by a bike length over Dungey. So they will run out for a third time to determine who goes to the final against Roczen. So this is it. One final run between James Stewart and Ryan Dungey. This is the irresistible force and the immovable object. Whoever wins this race goes to the finals. Whoever loses, they can't do any better than third today. And there's a lot of pride and ego on the line. These two are very respectful with each other most of the time. But under the helmet, on the starting line, Rick Johnson, you've got to imagine they would hate to lose to one another.
But the factor that you have in Supercross when you hate another rider or that you despise him or you want to beat him is that you can get physical with him. Here in Straight Rhythm, you just have to be better than the next guy. You cannot cross the line. You cannot interfere. You just have to beat him.
That's right. No excuses. It's just Dungey and Stewart. Who's faster? We're going to find out. Dungey getting wildly animated in the scrubs, doing everything he can. He told me earlier, he said, this is going to come down to squeezing that last 1% of speed. And they are wheel to wheel. Slight advantage for Dungey. Stewart comes back, side by side again. This section has been advantage Stewart, and I think it worked out again. He jumped over the entire Dragon's back. He has the edge. Last speed check, a series of tabletops. Dungey's going to have to put the power down. Stewart has to beat. Champions. And Dungey had something special there at the end. He was so much lower in the tabletops, he got close. But Stewart jumping that entire dragon back in the middle. Ultimately, that was the edge. Nice sign of respect for these two and a huge cheer from the crowd.
Great respect for both of these champions. And it was great. Jason, awesome job calling that. I just sat back and enjoyed the race. It was unbelievable. But I got to give it to Ryan Dungey. This is not his forte. This is not normally does, but he looked phenomenal. But it was James Stewart, the king last year, brought it back together. Now, as we watch this, this was the middle section where James Stewart made the difference. What he does is you notice his front wheel's a little bit lower, so he can be a little bit more aggressive as soon as he lands, and that was the difference. He scrubs a little bit harder there as he goes up this.
That
he
jump.
Just wheel taps, and then boom, clears the whole section, and that was the difference.
And then this dragon back here gave him a little more speed entering the whoops. Starts to pull away.
Yep.
And we'll see this next dragon back. Stewart didn't even touch the last part of it.
Yep.
And now he has the advantage. But Dungey definitely had a little trick here at the end to close up. Not enough.
But we talked about it before, and Dungey, very animated, working very much. So he's going to walk away from this a better Supercross racer and a more dangerous Ryan Dungey come 2016.
Well, here's the amazing part. Dungey put in his fastest run in that round where he lost, because they were both pushing so far.
That's awesome.
This is our runoff for third place. So the two riders in the lights class that were eliminated in the semifinals will meet up. So it's Jesse Nelson and Jordan Smith, and the winner of this race will be considered third overall in the lights class. Smith is on your left, rider's right, number 39, a Honda. Nelson on the number 13, KTM. And Nelson, I think, was a little quicker than Smith throughout practice and qualifying, but Smith really brought something special to try to beat Malcolm Stewart in his previous run, so he has a little confidence and momentum coming into this. Small edge for Nelson on the 13 early.
Smith starting to make his way back up. We've seen that happen here, Jason, in the first third. The right lane seems to be a little bit quicker, but Jesse Nelson starting to pick it back up. But it's going to be, once again, the whoops is going to make the difference.
The first dragon back, then over this plateau, and then another dragon back jump here, and it leads him to that whoop section, and it is as close as it gets by a nose right now as Nelson. Down the stretch they come. The fight for third. Nelson's just ahead. What a race!
You know, we talked about one mistake making a difference. No, at this level, they're all making little tiny mistakes. It's the guy that's not giving up and keeping that intensity, and that's how Smith won this, is he never gave up. He was on the rev chip the whole time. Here we see him going in, or we see Jesse Nelson going into the whoops and not giving up. He's pushing hard, but he drops the wheel a little bit, and then right there, bucks a little bit, and you see Smith sideways hanging it out, and he gets up in there. Next thing on the step on, step off, he pulls it off, and Smith advances.
Yeah, at this point, it cannot be clean and error-free, because they're pushing over the limits, and Smith goes on to take the win.
By nose.
By knob.
So this is it. Nelson has to win this one, or he'll end up fourth. No trophy for him. Or he could beat Jordan Smith in this, and we'll have a third race between them. So Jordan Smith has the edge right now in the battle for third in the lights class. Young man out of North Carolina, the number 39, Nelson, a 21-year-old out of Northern California, on the lucky number 13.
Shout out to all our friends back in North Carolina, back in Rayford, watching, and Helen, Blake, and Haley, everybody having a good time back there, and all my buddies that defend this beautiful country that we live in. So thank you, guys. Let's watch some racing. And it's Smith with an advantage over Nelson. So Nelson has to pick it back up, or this is gonna be the end of it for him. But in this section right here is where the right lane has been quicker and quicker.
And Nelson does draw back even with Smith. Then Smith able to get back ahead.
We'll see what happens over this drag and back. A lot of you guys are right there. We see Smith with the, I'm so impressed how hard he is pushing and letting it rock side to side.
Oh, Smith almost throws it away. And Nelson with a mistake too. They're pushing again over the edge. I think that is allowed Nelson to get the lead. No, it's still Smith. What a recovery.
As Smith comes up over, jumps a little bit, but it is Smith that walks away with the win.
Wow, that was an exchange of mistakes in that loop section. Smith made the bigger error, but he didn't lose enough ground to give it up to Nelson, and he will ultimately finish third here in our lights class.
And that's where strength and determination will beat out technique a lot of times, because both of these guys, one guy made one more mistake than the other. Here we see he floats it, drops the wheel, gets bucked, and he just keeps hanging on. So great job, and congratulations to Smith.
So Jordan Smith, third in our lights class. That'll push Nelson down to fourth.
He drops the wheel. You can see he gets over. Now the wheel comes up a little bit high and starts to buck, and he drops it. But this is where strength comes in. He just holds on really tight, pinches with his knees, and then on the gas. When in doubt, gas it out, and great job by Smith.
How scary is it to have the front wheel dip like that?
It's like watching your life flash in front of you. I mean, these guys are doing it so much more aggressive than we did back in the 80s and stuff like that. But, man, I'm telling you, for an instant, you think you're going to die.
So we'll continue our runoffs for third place. Now to the open class. It'll be Ryan Dungy against Justin Brayton. Dungy so close to making the finals, just beaten out by James Stewart. Brayton just edged by Ken Roczen. So a pair of KTM riders, the Red Bull KTM of Dungy, number 5, the VTOsports.com KTM of Brayton, the number 10.
But remember, this is not just a one and done. It's the same format for third place as it's going to be for the whole day.
Good start for Dungy out of the hole as a little lead, but look at Brayton make up ground on him on the 10 and come right back. Little mistake from Dungy.
It's amazing that we're calling out mistakes and they're just so minute that we wouldn't have even noticed that in Supercross.
Yep.
But with straight rhythm just being jumping and bumping and whoops and stuff, there we see Brayton with another move over that dragon back and work his way back up to the front.
Yeah, Brayton sent it, but still couldn't match Dungy's speed to the whoops, and now Dungy's got an edge. We're coming down to the finish. It's the last big jump. A series of rollers. And Dungy wins the first matchup against Brayton in the race for third. We'll give you the lap time. Yeah, Dungy a 41.5. That's a little off of what he had when he was racing Stewart. So you're really seeing how the two riders push each other.
As we focus on number 10, Brayton, you can see his feet come off. What he's trying to do is basically keep as much weight low as possible. And by shooting that weight back, it's helping force the nose down to get him back on the ground a little bit quicker. Because when you're attached to the pegs, if you move around, you're going to adjust the bike one way or the other. He's trying to get more force to that front wheel.
They are finding every little edge they can get out here.
The intensity that these guys are hitting this section, and it's great because they know they just got to make it to there. It's like, imagine when you're swimming in a pool and you're trying to swim underneath the water back and forth and back and forth. You see the light, you're trying to get to it and trying not to drown. That's what these riders are doing, pushing that 100%.
So one more run for third in the open class. Brayton here on the 10 against Dungy on the 5. Dungy won the first race between the two of them. So let's see if Brayton can push it to 3. Brayton has been very good at this event. The difference has been that
Dungey and Roczen have been great. So Roczen was able to eliminate Brayton from going to the finals the first time around. Dungey was able to win the first of his trophy race against Brayton this time.
You know, we've been talking about how this race is for fun, but at this moment, there is nothing that matters more in their complete universe to these two riders than finishing third and beating this guy next to him. That's what I love about motocross and a lot of other things. I know some of the special forces guys that are so intense with their CQB and stuff like that. It takes away all your worries. Right now, Ryan Dungey is not worrying about his mortgage or anything. He's worried about beating Justin Brayton.
Yeah, there's full focus on this track for 40-some seconds. Slight edge for Dungey at the number five. Brayton trying to come back. Dungey gets sideways. Is that the opening that Brayton needed? We're to the final set of tabletop jumps. Brayton keeps closing, but he's going to run out of time. Dungey wins it, and with that, he is going to finish third in 2015 Red Bull Straight Rhythm.
And Dungey pulls off a 41.8. He's going faster and faster each time. Great job by Ryan Dungey.
So Dungey just eliminated by James Stewart from a shot at the finals. He'll still be on the podium with third place. Brayton ends up considered fourth overall. And a great effort from Dungey, and the fans salute that. Boy, that was a great show, team, both he and Brayton, and also his runs against Stewart. Let's go back to this race.
And notice how animated Ryan Dungey is. And this is where I think that he's learning every run, and he's going to walk away with this a better Supercross rider. Because you notice Dungey always in Supercross is always kind of robotic and stiff. But now he seems very animated, and as I said, he's going to walk away a better Supercross racer.
Here they are in the starting line area. That is McElrath with the purple gear. And this is the Geico rider of Malcolm Stewart. Stewart brothers trying to sweep this thing. Malcolm in the lights class, and James, the older brother, in the open class.
I don't know if they can go to the betting odds that much quicker, but I would give the advantage to Malcolm Stewart. But McElrath, he gains confidence after every run, every race, and so it's anybody's trophy. Well, double clutch by Malcolm, and that gives McElrath the whole shot.
But Malcolm quickly comes back, throwing the bike sideways, scrubbing it. Here's the first speed check. They slow down and then accelerate through these jumps. Slight edge, and I mean slight, to Malcolm Stewart. About half a bike, and right there is where he opens it up. So now McElrath is going to have to dig deep.
Unless Malcolm makes a big mistake, McElrath is going to have to wait till the second round.
And this is an event so well suited to Malcolm Stewart's talents. Amazing skills on the motorcycle, great speed, and he looks to have this first run of the Lights Finals in hand. Malcolm Stewart on top.
Man, he's gonna be tough to stop with a run like that. That was nearly perfection. About as well as he could do it on a 250. And we'll show you what it looked like. McElrath's gonna have to find an answer for race number two, or it's over.
Malcolm Stewart showing what it's like. Give him 40-some seconds to do damage, and he can go as fast as anybody on that number 50.
As you notice, watch as he comes up, he keeps that torso low, but when he makes a mistake, he's so big and strong, you don't see the mistake as much because he can correct it, and that's where strength comes in.
And at this point, he has McElrath covered. Yeah, it looked like there were a few mistakes, but he didn't really lose any time while he did it. At this point, just powers across to the finish line. But there will be a rematch. It's best of three. Stewart doesn't have the first place trophy yet. McElrath, if he loses this one, it's over. Malcolm Stewart will be crowned champ. So Stewart has the opportunity to control his own destiny here. It's a best of three format, but if Stewart wins the first two, it's over. We'll see if the quiet man from North Carolina, McElrath, can push this to a round of three.
A lot of confidence out of Malcolm Stewart that first round, so let's see what he brings to the plate.
And scrubbing that bike all the way to the stops, the handlebars from one side as far as they can go to the other, and it is wheel to wheel. McElrath is bringing a real challenge to Malcolm Stewart this time.
They're head-to-head at this point, and later on is where we've seen the right lane actually be a little quicker mid, but then the left lane comes back at the end. But Malcolm Stewart pulling away at this point.
And here's that dragon back section we were talking about before. It was an edge for James Stewart. Same thing for Malcolm. Time running out. Can Shane McElrath come back and push it to a third race? It looks like Malcolm Stewart has it. McElrath is close, but not close enough. Through the rollers, Malcolm Stewart is going to win straight
was so strong last year on a 450 and now is the straight rhythm champion in the lights class. I don't know what that three means, but
three. Show some strength there.
He's a Dale Earnhardt fan. Throwing out a number three there.
Well, a lot of people thought the Stewart brothers could potentially sweep this and win both classes. Malcolm has done the job in the light class. James won the first matchup in the open class. Ken Roczen is the last man standing to try to prevent the Stewart sweep. Let's show you McElrath against Stewart.
Stewart with an advantage at this point, can't see anything but can hear. That's the one thing that you don't realize, that you hear the other guy beside you and behind you. These bikes run so loud. Even though they have a sound restriction on them, you can still hear them and feel that vibration. So Malcolm Stewart with an unbelievable job getting, you know, scrubbing speed here and maintaining his lead. See the brakes are on. Hold that main. That's what happened to Vince Friese. He missed the brakes. And here, triples, Demanuels himself all the way through. Triples the last section. There's your champion.
That's it, Malcolm Stewart, proving he can ride the 250 lights bike just as well as he did the open size bike last year. Well, here it is,
the
finals. Last year, James Stewart was facing off against Justin Brayton at this time. Now we have brought the world and national champion Ken Roczen from Germany over. Lives and trains in the United States now. He's as good as they come in Supercross racing in the United States also. I don't know how you could pick a favorite between these two.
Well, a slight correction there was the Stewart brothers that went head-to-head last year for the first place. So now we have both German and American represented, both of these guys on Suzuki. So great showing for Team Suzuki.
Roczen and Stewart battling it out. Slight edge to Stewart.
Roczen making a comeback.
Yeah, I think Roczen is edged back ahead of the 94. The Soaring Eagle Jimmy John Suzuki against the Yoshimura Suzuki of Stewart. Similar equipment, and right now Roczen has the edge.
But now let's see what James does. He jumps over the top now. Is he going to make up the time in the whoops?
I think he has. In fact, he's taking the lead. The entrance to the whoops continues to work for Stewart. Now it's side by side through the tabletops. A little bit quicker is Roczen. Can he use it to get the lead? Down the stretch they come. James Stewart comes out on top.
I apologize for that, Ouija. You were right. It was Brayton against Stewart for the main event last year. So right now, James Stewart is sitting in the camper seat, and they're still the man to beat.
Man, that was incredible between these two. Four or five times they swapped the lead.
But it was the whoops that made the difference, that dragging back and then the long section of whoops, where James Stewart seems to have a little bit more. He just throws it in there with a little bit, not reckless, but just confidence. When he comes through there, he seems to go from one bike length behind to one bike length in front.
Yeah, absolutely. That's where he got around Dungy, and he did the same thing. At this point, you think this race is all Roczen, but here we go. The dragging back, Stewart starts making up ground.
Yep, he hits just the first two bumps, clears it, and as he comes into here, everybody hesitates. He doesn't hesitate at all, lowers his body, gets behind it, and notice he's on the far right, running as fresh a dirt as possible, trying to avoid those ruts and shooting him side to side.
So the dragging back and the whoops, all the difference. Roczen might have been quicker through the entire track, but it allowed Stewart to take the win, and that's about as close as it gets, half a wheel length at the end. It's best of three. Roczen will have another shot at it.
Exactly. And how much did Kenny learn from that? But what he couldn't see was that dragon back where James just hit the second one, cleared all the way up and over the top. So nobody is picking up on that. That's the one, you know, the one trump card. I hate to use the word trump, but the one trump card that James Stewart has over everybody else. It's that second jump on the dragon back.
So this is it, Ken Roczen against James Stewart. Will it be the final matchup between them? If James Stewart wins it, he is your two-time now champion of Red Bull Straight Rhythm. If Ken Roczen wins, we'll go to a runoff and we'll take him for a third time.
If we have our way, Ken Roczen is gonna win this and we're gonna have a 3-1, just like we did with Dungy and Stewart. But Stewart was very strong, but Roczen very fast as well. So Roczen was the fastest qualifier, so hopefully he learns that one trump card in the middle on the dragon back where he hits, clears over the top, because he has the speed in the whoops, has the speed everywhere, and they're on virtually identical bikes.
Yeah, Roczen had the lead on Stewart, then there was one jump in the middle of the course where Stewart made up all his time, and that ultimately was the difference. So can Roczen here on the 94 figure that out? And how hard is that, Rick Johnson, to have a section you haven't jumped that way and then suddenly do it in action right in the middle of a race?
He doesn't know it. He didn't see it. He just had, if he's lucky, somebody saw it, is watching it, and then told him what was going on. But to try something new at 100% is so scary and so wacky. But let me just tell you, these guys are committed that hard. If he knows about it, he'll do it. I can promise you that.
Okay, so we're going to see when we get down to that section, will Roczen match Stewart jumping that dragon back, which gives a huge edge on speed in the whoops. So much speculation on what would happen when you drop the talent of Ken Roczen into this event. Could he potentially end James Stewart's reign in Red Bull Straight Rhythm? He certainly gave it a great run the first time, but he's got to beat him here or Stewart will have the win.
Well, Big James isn't here, but I'll bet he wishes that he was, because his youngest son is now the champion of Straight Rhythm in the lights class, and his older son, James, is going for gold again.
Ken Roczen, the only one standing between the Stewart brothers, sweeping the two classes. The Fairplex in Pomona, California comes to life. The finals in the open class, Stewart and Roczen. And like you said, the equipment, very similar between the two of them. Now, Stewart has been at it as far as testing the motorcycle since the beginning of September. Roczen had some time off with a back injury and a minor surgery. Said he really only hit the Supercross test track here in the U.S. this week. But no excuses. He feels ready to go. Certainly has been fast throughout the weekend.
Well, I've been talking with Mike Webb about, you know, James has been out there, Blake Baggett's been out there, Roxon's been out there, and also Brock Tickle. And actually, Blake Baggett's been very, very quick, so he's getting ready for the Supercross season, but he didn't feel he was a scrubbing type of guy, so he's going to work on building up his momentum for next year.
Yeah, each team is sending their best foot forward. So it's Roczen for his team, the RCH Soaring Eagle, Jimmy John Suzuki team, Yoshimura Suzuki with James Stewart, two of the biggest names in this sport, facing off in the finals. And Roczen gets out quick. Stewart responds. Stewart into the lead. Roczen makes a mistake, and what has happened to Roczen?
He made a mistake going over there, and all of a sudden he just waved it off. So James Stewart, unless he has a big crash, is going to walk away the Straight Rhythm champion.
I'm not sure if it is a motorcycle problem or a problem for Roczen himself, but it appears that the Stewart brothers are going to sweep Straight Rhythm if James can just hang on. James looks over, wondering where Roczen is.
As I said, you can hear him right now. The crowd is so stoked to see James Stewart back. He sat out for 16 months, and now he's a Straight Rhythm champion.
James Stewart wins Straight Rhythm for the second year in a row. Ken Roczen did just come across the finish line, so the bike was able to at least complete the run. Very interesting, and here's Stewart going to celebrate with his brother as they swept the two classes. And Roczen, congratulations as well. Not sure what happened to him on the 94, not able to give James Stewart the battle that he wanted to.
But I can't imagine the emotion that James Stewart is feeling right now, because he sat on this very emotionally, and he played it off at the beginning of the show saying, well, I just took some time off and this and that. But I talked to James a little bit via text at the beginning of when that started going down, and it was emotionally very, very hard on him. So for him to come back, here we see James with both of them identical starts coming off. But this has got to be so big for him emotionally to be back in the winner's circle.
So we're trying to figure out what the situation here was with Roczen. Certainly out of the hole, was very aggressive and very capable. Right about here is where we have problems.
He overjumped, and then I think he might have went over the line or something like that. That might have been what we couldn't see, is that he had a hard scrub. He overjumped, and it bounced him to the far left. He might have landed on there and figured, I've already crossed over, so I'm not gonna mess up James. So respect to him, but hopefully that was just the problem.
Yeah, the white line in the middle of the course, if you cross over that, you are automatically DQ'd. So that could have potentially been the situation. We'll find out about that in a bit. Meanwhile, Will has caught up with both Stewart brothers, the winners of both classes.
Yes, I have indeed, guys. They're both down here. Congratulations to you both. Malcolm, I was chatting to you earlier, and you said this is exactly how you saw it playing out. Somewhat of a self-fulfilling prophecy here.
Yeah, no, man, it's an awesome weekend. And for me and my brother to go 1-1 at this event, I couldn't thank Red Bull Straight Rhythm enough for doing this. And we'll definitely be back next year for sure. But
Man, we made history today. That's what I'm talking about.
Yes, you did indeed, and congratulations to you, Jones, of course, for taking the open class. That was quite a battle at the end there, but you were capitalizing on mistakes that were getting made. Don't you think that's the key thing here today?
Yeah, I just want to say one thing. I appreciate everybody that's been supportive of me being off this whole time, and you guys don't understand how good it feels to be back. I mean, I'm just stoked right now, and my brother for stepping up and winning his class. There was a lot of pressure on me, but the first time I won the first race, you guys were cheering for me. Like, it's been over a year since I had that, and it's so unbelievable, so thank you so much.
Well, it's good to see you back here and, of course, come back and, of course, take the title here at Red Bull Straight Rhythm for a second time. Let's just talk about the race really quickly, though. Obviously, for you, I think the key things here were the whoops and definitely coming off that Dragon's back. Would you say that's the case?
Yeah, I mean, my team, we've been working and testing some new stuff. I wasn't sure how I would do. I mean, haven't raced over a year, so, you know, this is probably one of the weakest points, but I don't know, every time I put my helmet on, those guys believed in me. And even though we were slow yesterday, they said, nah, dude, you're a racer. When the crowd comes out there and it counts, you'll step it up. And that's all we did today. So, man, it's such a relief right now.
And how has this set you up going into the Supercross season?
I mean, we still got a lot of work to do. I mean, I got a lot, we got a lot of work to do. But come back and still, you know, pull off performance like that. But, you know, like I said, me and my brother winning, I want to thank him. My mom and dad, they're on their anniversary, so this is our anniversary present to my mom and dad. Me and Malcolm wanted to, and then again, I just want to thank my team. Those guys been, we had a rough year last year, you know, sticking behind me, and then the fans, again, you guys don't understand how much I love you guys, and this is for you.
Well, happy anniversary indeed to your mom and dad. Congratulations, Malcolm. Congratulations, James. These are our 2015 Red Bull Straight Rhythm Champions.
That's got to feel good.
Well, as I said, you know, I went through a devastating injury and sat out for a long time. And then when you realize that nobody cares about you, and you think that your life is over and everything, and you can see the emotion and you can hear it in James. It actually chokes me up a little bit because he cares so much about this. And everybody thinks, he doesn't care. He's got money. He's got fancy cars and all this different stuff. But this is why James Stewart loves what he does. He loves racing. He loves competing. And to see two brothers get out there and get 1-1 is just, it's great.
The Red Bull signature moment goes to James Bubba Stewart for back-to-back championships here at Straight Rhythm. After a year off from racing due to a ban in the 2015 motocross and supercross seasons, Bubba returned to competition with drive, vengeance, and his trademark Bubba Scrub in the 16-rider open class. And after beating Ryan Dungey in the semis, the final came down. Ken Roczen versus Stewart, and Stewart bested the German in consecutive races, clinching his second title. Congratulations to James Stewart on repeating here at Straight Rhythm and capturing the Red Bull signature moment. Let's send it down to Sal Masekela.
Thank you, Jason, and thanks to all of you for hanging out with us here at the Fairplex in Pomona in beautiful Southern California. A lot of horsepower displayed on this old racetrack. And once again, we exceeded expectations with this new motocross format known as Straight Rhythm. Looking forward to coming back next year. Congratulations to our winners, the brothers Stewart, Malcolm in the lights class, and James in the open class. An incredible comeback for him. We will see you next time.